Hello everyone and welcome to another episode of Design Meetup 2.0 powered by IDF Kerala and co-sponsored by Experion Technologies. When it comes to users, one of the famous quote is, don't make me think. We always take care of giving the best and smooth experience to the user without any distractions or disturbance while performing the task. As a result, we always read, listen, and practice more things about UX, design systems, design thinking, research, usability, etc. But today's topic is a little contradiction to this concept. How friction can smoothen the design? Well, this is about introducing various aspects and thoughts which are regarded as friction making a better design and how it reflects on interaction design. Coming to our presenter, who has started his career as an automobile engineer, leaped into the domain of industrial designing, and later working the way around, he shifted to user experience design. I would like to introduce the young and most energetic Mr. Anirudh Prakash, user experience designer at Experion Technologies, to share some valuable insights on friction in design. A recorded version of this webinar will be available in our YouTube channel. For the ease of better experience, we have made a small friction by muting the audience mic during the presentation time. Please raise your queries in the comment section. Although we have an exclusive Q&A session after the webinar where the audience can interact and discuss. For those of you just joining us, welcome. All right, without taking more time, I'm handing over the mic to Anirudh. Anirudh, all yours.
Thank you, Prima. Thank you so much. And hi, everyone. I hope you're doing great and staying safe there. So let me start with my presentation. So yes, it's friction in design. And yes, of course, there would be a doubt arising about the topic. Why would someone introduce a physics class lesson into design? That's true. So friction is actually opposition of a moving body or putting a moving body into rest. That's the actual definition of friction. And so one might wonder, what is friction doing in design? If at all, the design should be something which is friction free. That's true. A design should be friction free also at the experience level. But the introduction of friction here is to make the answer, the solution for the design to have an uninterrupted and smooth flow so that the experience is much more diverse. I'll start up with a few of the examples that I've come up with and then relate it how friction can function with the design as well as make a much better experience by interaction. So moving into one of my first example, the pill bottle. This is something that have been around for 200 years of use because this is one of the most convenient way of carrying medications, and they have been evolving over its shape for quite a few years, and people are, you know, it's very much easy to carry around. It's it has a labeling section, and also one of the best features, it has a child lock. So pill bottle hadn't much change over the years until let's say 50 years back, there came a need for change. That's simple, because every time you open up a pill bottle, there's a big chance this could happen. You aim for two tablets or two pills, and there's a big chance 15 of them comes out. And now what you do is you take up the remaining for 14 or 13 and put it back. And there's a big chance these medications are exposed to the environment, and there's a chance of fungal infection transmission. So what essentially happens is, you are finding a bit of difficulty in the design. It's not the design is wrong, but the way it is rendered is having a bit of scratch and problems. So what do we do? That's true. For the same reason, there was an introduction of something called the blister pack. It's very convenient. It's very easy to carry around. And let's say if you want just two pieces, you just cut off two pieces and that's it. You're very much saved of a lot of space, and it's pretty much easy to carry and use. Also, it actually serves the function. So what happens is you have huge amount of tablets and pills. And now what you need is to have just one of the tablet. And here, instead of making a redesign for the complete setup, we have introduced a bit of friction into the flow, and that is blister pack. So now you might be having a slight idea of how friction is playing in design rather than completely changing the overall design. And for the same reason, there were two betterment that happened after the introduction of blister pack. So one was accidental overdose, especially people who are of older age, and they never the number of people who actually had death due to overdose actually dramatically reduced to zero in England during the 90s and 80s, because that was a time when people had to carry around or use medication frequently because we didn't have much good healthcare back that time. So medication was their companion, and blister pack was their the solution. Now, also, you actually have the less amount of infection that could occur on the tablets which are being exposed also. So we are bringing friction in the design in a sort of a blister pack. Now we have understood how blister pack is affecting the design rather than completely changing it. Now let's say how about a friction introduction in a huge space, let's say a system design, transportation or logistics work. I'll give you another example. So this is about Houston Airport. This is one of the busiest airports in Texas. And there are multiple airports for the same place. And so the classic problem that arises in this place is the waiting period. The passengers always raised concern that they had to wait a huge amount of time before they could get their luggages or backpacks or belongings after clearance, after they board from the plane. And yes, as usual, the authorities wanted to make a big solution. So what do? Yes, exactly. They spend a lot of more money on this, introducing new technologies that could speeden up the process, like faster conveyor belt, introduction of multiple staffs on multiple shifts so that the progress and the operation is smoothened and optimized to a very smaller time. But yes, and successfully, airport authority could curb the wait period to overall of 7 minutes. So this is how a scenario actually happens. The plane lands, user gets out of the plane, and it takes at least of 1 minute before the terminal. And now there's a small wait period of 6 minutes before the user can get the belongings or the baggage claim. So now a solid 7 minutes of time is being spent before the user can get to the luggage. And still, again, the users were very much frustrated because 7 minutes is still considered as a longer wait period for the users. So this time, instead of employing more employees and more gadgets or technologies or even spending huge amount of money, they thought, let's hire some designers and let's see if they could bring in design changes or better solution. So what they did, they hired a team of strategic designers and they studied the flow of how people flow, go from the landing spot to terminal and from there to the baggage. And they studied how is this operation carried out. Now they have an idea, okay, there's a wait period of over 6 minutes from the terminal to baggage. And finally, the designers came to a conclusion that the problem was waiting. People didn't want to wait, even if it's 6 minutes. 6 minutes is considered as a long wait time. And the designers were to bring out a solution that doesn't cost much. That's true. They were able to bring up a design solution where there wasn't use of any logistic change or any introduction of any technologies or even change in revenue. They just wanted to work on the strategy or add a friction so that the users doesn't feel it is waiting. So this is actually how the solution is. And so let's have a quick round. You could all give your answers in the comment section of how they made solution. And the solution is pretty much easy. They didn't employ any new technologies or money was spent on this. It's pure idea. So all are, I'll just give like 10 seconds and put up your answers on the comment box if that's possible. And I'll come up with a solution in 10 seconds. Okay. Okay. Let's have a round of look in the end. So I'll come up with the solution. The solution was pretty much simple. They just asked the pilot to park the plane at least 6 minutes of walk distance from terminal. It's simple. They made to park the plane as far as at least there's a 6 minutes of walking distance from the terminal and the plane. And this way we're saving a huge amount of money on transportation, logistics, or even the operation. And the complaint rates reduced to zero. So now you understood how friction has been used in redefining the solution, not by redesigning the actual solution. So it's a bit of addition of a bit of friction to the design so that the experience is not being killed. Now, there's one more the classic scenario where this is something which everyone of you might have noticed at some point, because waiting at the floor for an elevator to come up. So, you know, it's a crowded place and everywhere it's the same issue, because there are a lot of people waiting at particular time and they are waiting for their elevator to show up, but it doesn't happen. So what do? They add multiple elevators, which did not solve the problem. Actually, it worsened the problem, because more elevators equal to more crowd. Then they thought, let's work on something like working on high speed motors, which could be employed on the lift technique. But nothing worked actually, because it worked for us, because adding more or increasing the features actually deteriorated the experience. That actually worsened the design. So I'll just let's see if you can give your answers in the comment box, and we'll discuss in the end. So the solution was pretty much simple. You people can guess it out. Let's see what the answer is. So moving forward, now how can this addition of friction make a much big difference in experience design or in a digital market or a digital product? Let's take back how search was done a few years back. Let's go back to at least 10 or 15 years back, where you actually you're making a search for a particular object, or let's say camera, and there are multiple of features at the beginning, before the search. You're swamped with a lot of features and accessories and advantages, and users are confused. Where should I start with? Because the more the feature you have, the more confused you become, and it actually takes your focus from the design. So what happened is, earlier there were two methodology of solving a problem. One was passing the complexity to the user, and second was solving the complexity by the designer for the user. And initially it was the first one, passing on the complexity. The users were made to find what they were at the beginning, and then making a final search. So let's say you were searching for something, there's a big chance you might have to go through 3 to 4 websites before reaching the one that you actually intended to see. That actually adds a lot of confusion, and you are still confused about which site should I prefer. They're showing a lot of solutions to me, more the features. So what in general, what actually we study is, the more the feature is, the less experience, because you will lose the focus of what you wanted to do. And for the same reason, we worked on it. This is how Google looked a few years back. You were given a lot of options, and now if you are searching for an image, there's a big chance you might not end up with the correct search. They might have the answer, they should have, but it takes a few minutes or the search to find out your correct solution. So that was how Google functioned a few years back. Now the designers evolved, and they just thought, let's redefine how we find the solution. So they said, let's give the users a simple start that would actually initiate a much better search. And from thereby, you give the users a much more listed out topics and search fields and results. So that's simple. And that's how we have a Google, which is very, very simple. And it has only 2 buttons, and it has been now being much more easier to do a Google search. This is how our introduction of a bit of friction into the small design has affected the output. Let's theoretically say, okay, there is no friction at all. Okay, let's say design has to be consistent. It should be consistent. It should have a singularity in it. So let's say this is a graph and followed by a button, which is the call to action. And if you say there is no friction, it should be consistent. That means the button color should be as the color of the paragraph itself. It should not be different because it has to be a similar thing. But the moment we introduce a bit of friction design, we are noticing a much better experience. We are having there's a huge gain on the focus, which is being captured by the application. Now you can understand how if there was no friction, probably the color of the button should be of the same side. But an introduction of friction actually made the experience much more simpler and intuitive. Let's take a much more simple example. We all have gone through this stage of progress bar in almost working with an application or registration, and there's this bar, and five out of ten times there's a big chance it might get stuck at one point. And the user has no idea, okay, should I leave the website? Is it happening? And there's a big chance you might leave this. But the same thing, if we represent it with a ripple effect, we actually tend to think that, okay, this is moving. This is not stuck at one point. It's actually progressing. So I'll wait for a few more minutes. And turns out there's a study and shows the bars with a ripple effect appears 11% more faster than the original one. Because we actually tend to think, okay, there's an animation. So I think this is not dead yet. It is working. It is progressing. So we might have the result in a few minutes. Except this very function is being used by YouTube, which has been tricking us over the years. It's simple. So let's say you're watching some video on YouTube and all of a sudden your power goes, or let's say the internet connection is rather bad. What happens is there's a red bar which flows across the screen, and at the initial this same bar will go very fast, but as it approaches the other side, the right side, it actually slows down. And at one point it actually freezes. It doesn't move. It doesn't even touch the other end. It's actually freezing at one point, making the user believe that, okay, this is not dead. The internet is going to come up in a few minutes, or the website or this page is going to load in some time. All you have to do is just be patient. Because instead of this, if they just show a blank screen where there is nothing happening, you might think, okay, there's internet connection and it might not come soon. But YouTube, as you know, brilliantly morph that by showing a solution that tends or makes the user think that, okay, this is going to happen sometime soon, so I'll wait for a few more minutes and that will work. But this doesn't work if the website is not loading in like 3 minutes. It actually goes off. It goes off with the jumping dinosaur, which comes up later on. So this is just to add a buffer. It's a friction to put you back in the website so that you don't leave the browser and probably leave the computer. They want you to stay there for a few more minutes. So they introduce this technique as a friction to make the user stay where they want. This is a classic example. So a few years before, we might have experienced a spinner, which has no point. It just rotates from there. And what happens is you have no idea whether we are progressing, or is the screen dead, or is there any point in waiting anymore? Because this is actually a bad experience, especially when it's coming to something related to transaction. Let's say you are making a transaction and all of a sudden this is what they appear. You might be a little confused and curious, okay, did I make the transaction or do I just start it again? It puts a lot of confusion and curiosity in the user. So this was one of the worst examples that could. So over the years, the internet failure screens have evolved, and this came up, the skeletal ones. Facebook had introduced a few years before. But one thing good about this design is that you can actually see, okay, there is something coming up on my screen. All I have to do is wait. Although I'm not sure what is coming up, but there is something in the screen that is showing up. All I have to do is wait. Although I am not sure what is the content, or also the period of wait is undefined. Again, there is a bit of curiosity being added, but at least we are aware that, okay, there is something happening. Although I had to wait for a few minutes. So that's how skeletal screen works. And finally, there was a much better iteration, which is the staggered data or the progressive loading of screen. It was much better because as soon as you open up the app or application which have a few or a bad internet connection, what they do is they essentially loads the data which can be rendered much faster, like the text or and graphic element, which only requires less amount of data. And for the same reason, they load the screens or images which are of higher quality, that will be loaded progressively. It is going to load up, but by the time you probably might have got the 60% of data which you required. Let's say you're reading a article and there's no need for an image to show up necessarily, but it could load up. But there is a friction being added in the process of showing, because in Spinner you are actually put in a blank screen. You have no idea what's going to happen. But in the progressive data screen, we are noticing something. There is something being delivered, and you almost have a good idea of what the screen would be appearing, rather than just making the user wait for the end to everything to load up altogether. Now, I'll show a big fan who uses friction as a functionality point. That's Google. It's very much interesting, because Google Photos is one of the best way to view your images, and they want you to offer the best experience. They want you to go through your images and memories in a much more efficient way. And for the same reason, they have divided the sections of the application less like this viewpoint, preload and loaders. So as soon as you open up the app, the first and foremost thing that you see is the viewpoint, and followed by the preload section, and followed by the loaders. So as you progress down, the quality of image is being deteriorated. Not deteriorated, it's being compromised to a point which is certainly not completely perceivable, but there is actually a compromise on the quality. Because the first thing you see is the viewpoint, and that should be delivered in the best quality. That's why you see the first images with brilliant quality. And as you scroll down, the quality, as you scroll down much faster, you can see it takes a few minutes, a few seconds before it actually leads to the best quality. So there is actually a trick that they follow in Google Photos. So what essentially happens is, if you take an image on the left side, the Retina thumbnail, which is of 71 kilobyte, it's of 352 by 530, and you resize it, you get the second one, that is 265 by 176. Here, the quality is not being compromised. It's being delivered with the best quality. But the same image on the extreme right, which is 265 by 176, is of a bit compromised quality. But the moment you resize it to 48 by 72 pixel, you barely notice that this image is being optimized for the quality. Because if you look closely, probably you might have to zoom in to see that there is a deterioration in the quality. But the best part is only 900 bytes is being used. So the application only use very less use of RAM usage. That means much faster scrolling. That delivers a very good experience, because this application actually takes a huge amount of RAM, because it has to work in at least 60 hertz for a fluidic scroll. And for the same reason, the application should have a huge amount of space being taken, and it cannot be taken by the placeholders, which actually takes 72 KB in the first place, but in the second one, they barely take half the space. So there was actually a story of how they developed it. Initially, they thought, let's have the default image is this one, or the one on the center. And they said, let's go by the theory of pixelation, which actually saves a lot of space. And that means more RAM can be saved. But they thought delivering an image which is pixelated might interfere with the quality of image or the experience. So they said, let's go by something called blur. So as soon as you scroll, they thought, let's all make the images a little more blur, and that will make it look appear charming. That's true. The image with blur quality actually looks good, but there were two drawbacks of using blur. One was it was very much costly to implement. And secondly, blur actually takes huge amount of RAM, because first you have to have the image, then optimize to make it a blur look. So they said, let's go by pixelation for something that is on scroll. Because as you scroll, you don't have to see something which is blur. We can actually see pixelation. And by the time the scroll stops, the pixelation can go to the best quality. So you are actually saving a lot of RAM. So that means the scroll is much faster. And for the same reason, they said, once you're opening an image, let's say you're clicking a particular image, that image should be delivered with the best quality. Like, it should not be pixelated to good quality. It should be somewhat like blur to good quality. So for the same reason, this is what happens. If you scroll much faster, this is what you notice on the Google Photos. But if you are to open an image, this is what happens. So opening up an image only happens once time. But so for the same reason, it should be given with much more better quality. That's why they implemented blur with an image, and on scroll, they used pixelation. So that's how Google have tackled the problem of saving a lot of RAM and space and having an experience delivered with the best quality. So now we have understood how adding a friction has helped with the functionality of design, you know, optimizing it, making a much more efficient design rather than implementing or redesigning the actual state. Now, let's go on to another aspect of friction, which actually gives you the sensation of accomplishment or achievement. This is something that is being followed by many, many brands around the world. I'll list out some of the examples. And here we see how a brand takes the aspect of friction and deliver the user with the product that actually gives them the sensation of achievement. This is something that I did. This is something created by myself. And for the same reason, there's a website called Purple Carrot. So Purple Carrot is one of the leading websites in States, and they actually deliver you food. Just like any other food delivery app, except they don't deliver you the cooked food. They give you the recipe. Let's say you want to celebrate your friend's birthday. There is a huge difference if you buy the cake and if you bake it. Because if you're baking it, you're actually giving something special. Or, you know, there's an emotional factor when you are giving the presentation in the form of your creation. Let's say you bake the cake, that's much easy. So what happens is the moment you want to bake a cake, you don't have half the ingredients. You have to go to the store, get that, this, and it could actually consume. And probably you might leave at the end and probably buy a cake of your own. But what essentially Purple Carrot does is they deliver you all the ingredients that you want in separate packages. Also, let's say you are having an ingredient, five ingredients, they attach you along a recipe of all the possible things that you could make with that five ingredients. So by this way, you are actually designing, or you are actually developing something of your own. You are making something by your own hand, and then you actually develop a sense of accomplishment and achievement. So that's how Purple Carrot could deliver a product which is already cooked, but that actually wouldn't have the effect of, you know, cooking, because once you cook and you eat, you feel it much better because it's something you made it out of your own hand. So there is the friction of not making the food by the Purple Carrot. That's one of the ideology, and it actually is working fine, and it's one of the most successful websites that to provide with such good quality of recipes and ideas to the user. So moving on to Airbnb, you all are aware of community sharing and a platform to, you know, hire or rent a house or place by anyone. So what they essentially have is every time there's an issue from the guest right away dials with the support team, and they would raise the complaint rather than contacting the host. So the development team or the background team of Airbnb thought, why don't we introduce the host as someone who is helping the guest rather than the support team? By this way, we are actually developing a good connection between the guest and the host. But at Airbnb, they said it might not work. This might be a problem because user might feel and might disturb the host, because there might be a frequent interruption of the guest asking various facilities to make their stay much better. But they were able to find, that was the assumption. The assumption was that the Airbnb guest might feel uncomfortable to contact the team of the host. But in reality, what happened was they could actually find that the guest was feeling much satisfied to help the guest, not rather complaining it around, because they could provide everything and complaint rate was almost zero, because nobody complained that the host did not help me to do this, even though I asked them, because they were ready to help. And this actually cultivated a very good relationship between the user and the host itself. So Airbnb is still following this feature where they try to cut out the technical team as much as possible, so that the user, the host, can actually interact with the guest rather than having a third person to help. So that's how Airbnb works with such a ideology. And the, finally, the one, the third one, the most famous, the IKEA, which have been one of the worst furniture design companies around the world, from Sweden. And so they have same version of a furniture, which is ready made. Also, something which can be made by ourselves. And I believe me, if you make or if you buy something which is to be later on assembled by yourself, you will feel much better, because it is actually giving the sensation of something completion, and you are actually building the design. You are the designer in this case, and for the same reason, you will be like, yes, this is something I accomplished. So I am having a sensation of achievement that I made from building my own furniture. So now you must have an understanding of how a friction actually functions for the design, as well as makes it much more smoother to have a to offer a design or a free experience in a much more simpler way. So that's all from my side. And now let's have a discussion and thoughts about the same.
Thank you, Anirudh. That was a wonderful section on using friction in design. And now this is time for question and answers. So I request our participants to come up with your questions. And also, if you have any point to add on to this particular topic, please feel free to unmute your mic and speak up.
Hi, Anirudh.
Hi.
I had a doubt.
So, yeah.
Just was thinking about your concept of the topics that you had spoken on when you were speaking about friction in design. So I was just thinking of what parameters that we could take up to evaluate whether the friction which we are bringing into the design is going to actually impact the user in the way they want, or whether it is going to make it difficult for the user. So is there method to check it?
Friction in design actually happens at a second stage. Let's say there's something designed already, and we are redesigning on that. Friction can be only added at a later stage, because there is a huge amount of research and thoughts to be added before bringing design. So let's say you have the design for the product. You might not be able to get it friction in the initial stage. You might have to wait and study how the function of that design is having onto the product or the solution, then that's how you come up with the friction, because friction is not necessarily breaking the actual flow. It is actually revamping the flow or automating the result that you, although the design result should be the same, you are actually releasing a step from the solution. Actually, you're closing up the gap between the initial problem and the solution. So it actually requires a huge amount of research. Let's say if it's related to a product, there will be a huge amount of research being studied on how the product actually delivers the result. For example, in the case of this airport, they actually had to study how much time the user would take to travel from the terminal to the nearest back image area. And there, what involves is they are actually learning how the user is interacting, what are the things that could be possibly avoided to reduce this time gap. It's basically a huge study and research being carried out before getting into a friction. So it's not a little easy to have friction, but the thought actually can be very provocative, because it can actually impact the design in a good way.
Thank you. So what we mean by friction in design is that at the end of the day, the customer has to have a better experience with what he's delivered with.
Exactly.
And so
exactly.
That justifies the amount of research or time spent in reaching the conclusion, right? Thank you.
Exactly. That's true. Also, I had come up with an example of the elevator. Does anyone know the answer of how they solve the problem of the waiting period in an elevator to get into an elevator? If someone has the answer, you could just share it. How they solve the problem of the elevator? It's pretty much simple. Let's say they might have added $1,000, not even 1,000, let's say below $1,000 of expense to make it much more efficient.
Yeah, Anirudh, this is Arun here.
Okay, Arun, hi.
Hey, hi. About this elevator, right? So one time when I was like, I did get a chance to, work in a building that was like, I think around 80 floors.
Okay.
So all these floors were like having a lot of companies, and then there were a lot of people who had to go, and there were, I believe, they were around three lifts. There's six lifts altogether. So one solution that they provided was to create junctions, or I don't know how to term it properly, junctions in different floors. Like, yes. For example, this lift goes from floor 1 to 40.
And, exactly.
If you want to reach the 62nd floor, then you have to go to 1 to 50, and then from there, take another elevator to from 50 to 62. Do you think that was the
you're getting close. Your answer is getting close. Actually, they the one you said, they actually worked on the log, the algorithm of how an elevator should work. Like, each of these elevators are being designated for a particular floor. That actually worked for only if a crowd is being contained around 20. If it's more than 20, this might not work. That your solution for that particular 20 group is actually working, but the actual solution they implemented was introduction of music and a good quality mirror. Actually, they just introduced a good music system as well as a very good clear mirror. You know, that actually really killed the time. So introduction, like you said, introduction of that was one idea, because if you add more lift, that means more problem and more people might be waiting for that. So it's actually proportionally increasing the problem rather than reducing the making a solution. It's actually multiplying the effect that is happening. So they said, why not think of something that is a little more simple, or implementing a simple solution.
In a cost-effective way,
that makes
sense, because everybody would be like, wanting to look at the mirror and see how they look. That's true. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Very good session. Very crisp. The way.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for that.
Thank you so much, Arun.
Anybody would love to share some of the points or experience, not only from this designing area, but our day-to-day life, or from their field, it could be this business perspective, or it could be from the development perspective. Anyone would like to share some points?
Hi, I'm Vandana. Hi, Anirudh. Could you talk a little about your wheelchair redesign project? I saw that in the portfolio.
Oh, okay. This is completely related to industrial design. So what was the issue? I actually went to Kollam Medical College. So most of the patients working there, those who were hospitalized there, were about 75 to 80. And most of them are, physically torn up. I mean, their health condition was making them, difficult to move from one place to another, especially going towards the restroom, or at least moving from one room to another. So they always had to have someone to help them, whatever it is, even if you just get up from the bed, they always have to, have someone take care of themselves. And because, moving, walking might be very much difficult for some of the patients. It could actually cause, probably some of the patients might be, want from walking, because the overweight was one of the issues those patients were facing. And for the same reason, they could not afford to live alone, or at least move from one place to another by their own. So my design for the wheelchair was to transferring the patient from the bed to the wheelchair, wanted to make it much more simple. You don't require someone's help move from the bed to the chair. That was the idea behind it. And So in short, we are actually helping the user to, reduce the necessity to have someone help you every time you need to get out of the bed or move from one place to another. So that was a redesign. So what essentially happens is you have a latch system attached on the wheelchair. So which upon you opening it, you can actually slide over it, and you don't require a third person's second person's help to move from yourself from the bed or wherever it is. It's actually it was the more prototype was made, but it was, since it was a college project, I couldn't spend much time on that. Also, it was a final year project. Thank you so much for looking into one of my works. I'm so glad someone had a chance to look at that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Antana, and thank you, Anirudh. Anyone else?
Anirudh, just a quick question, and once again, thank you for the session. Like, it was some good new insights for me as well. So,
thank you.
I was trying to relate the friction with some of the tool we use. So, was trying to read whether it's correct or not. That's I'm not sure. So in Gmail, when you write, if you are using Gmail, in the body, if there is a keyword called attachment or something, and we have it attached a file or something in that mail, and click send, there will be a call, right?
Alert, yes, alert, yeah. Yes.
So that is something related to the friction itself, right? So
actually, yes, you are actually being pulled back from doing something. You are actually being barred from doing something wrong, or it's actually a sort of a safety mechanism happening there. This is you are going to send a mail. Let's stop you from doing it before you add the attachment. So that actually is putting a friction onto the user from getting the final result. That's true, actually. Yes, because it's the same way how the tablets get out. They don't want the excess of tablets to get out. They want you to have just one. Mm-hmm. And that is how friction is functioning there also. I think that's very much relevant to what I spoke today. Yes, the Gmail story.
I was trying to relate a common example, which I think most of us have used. And in the first example, you mentioned like the tablet example, that pill box.
Yeah.
Pilling out of one pill. I think if you look at the new, what do you call?
Tic-tac. Are you talking about
Tic-tac? Tic-tac and all.
Yes, yes.
In the lid.
There is actually, yes. The lid actually has a protrusion so that we twist it, you actually get one tablet out of it. Yes, that's true. Right. Actually, the introduction of this blister pack was for the same case, the users who are above this age, because there's a chance that patients might be having Alzheimer's, and there's a big chance they could overdose, because they might be only prescribed to have two tablets, but there is a chance they could have three or four. So for the same reason, it was very easy for the person who is living along with the patient to cut off just three, and just that reminds him, okay, I have to only take two of this. So it's actually functioning in a good part, and also making a safety feature added to the function and design.
Correct. I think that's a valid point. Like based on, so when we think about a patient, now we forget about the age group or the disease or the condition they have. So.
Exactly. We it's always recommended to think of someone of aged people, especially even in airports. You know how difficult it is for them to navigate or find their solutions. It's pretty much very much required that we also take in care of put a thought about how it would work for someone who is elderly.
Yeah, once again, thanks, Andrew, and thanks for
thank you. Thank you all the team and everyone who has joined. I'm so glad I could be of some use of your valuable time.
I would like to thank each and everyone who took their valuable time from a busy day to attend this webinar. And we are really sorry for the disturbance occurred during the session due to bad internet connection. We'll take care of it in the coming sessions. And a special thanks to those participants, Joel, Arun, Vandana, and Jinsen, who actively participated in the Q&A session. We just touched the tip of friction in design. There are a lot to discuss more. So if you would like to get to know more details, please write to us. We would like to come back with another webinar on that. Or if you have any specific topic which you would like to have a session on, that also please write to us. We are available on social media like Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, at the rate of IDFKerala. You can also write us IDFKerala@hotmail.com. We have an exclusive IDF Kerala community in Interaction Design Foundation website. I hope we will meet all of you next week at the same time with another webinar. Till that, stay safe and stay connected. Thank you.